This video is sponsored by Brilliant. If you stick around to the end, I'll give you a link to 20% off a premium membership. For many people, summer means travel. And whether it's going home to visit family or exploring a new place, travel means using some form of fossil fuel-reliant transportation. But the problem I've encountered as I browse through the various train, plane, and bus tickets has been finding out which is the greenest option. When I look towards news headlines, climate activists like Greta Thunberg seem to be flocking towards trains as a way to travel without excessive carbon impact. But does a 24-hour long train ride have less of an emissions footprint than a 2-hour flight? I feel like it's important to at least try and figure out some environmental guidelines for deciding which transport option to take, especially when considering that in 2014, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change reported that the transportation sector accounts for 23% of the world's total greenhouse gas emissions. So today, I have a simple question. When traveling, which form of transportation requires the least emissions? Unfortunately, the answer to that question is not so simple. The carbon footprints of planes, trains, and cars depend on a number of contextual factors, like infrastructure, the build of the vehicle, location, and distance. So instead of trying to decide on the ultimate form of green transportation, we're going to look at how various factors, including distance and number of passengers in the vehicle, change the emissions footprint of different transportation modes. So let's start with a relatively short distance, a quick business trip between Toronto and New York City. National Geographic looked at the various transportation options, and according to their number crunching, the plane wins the award for the shortest distance traveled at 352 miles or 566 kilometers, with cars and buses taking second place at 472 miles or 759 kilometers. And trains chugging along in last place with a 544 mile or 875 kilometer transit. So planes have drastically less distance to travel, but that doesn't necessarily equate to fewer emissions. Instead, if we look at the amount of passengers transported per trip combined with the gasoline fuel equivalent of the mode of transportation, we get some surprising numbers. According to National Geographic, the electric car is by far the most efficient fuel-wise. But taking the bus also requires fairly low emissions. And then it gets pretty interesting when we switch our attention to planes, traditional cars, and trains. National Geographic pins the total CO2 per passenger for a plane trip at 75.3 kilograms and claims that a train requires 84.3 kilograms. But these numbers vary a little bit depending on how it's calculated. Part of the reason why a train can be so emissions intensive is that many trains still run on diesel. In this case, the train that reaches almost all the way to Toronto from New York is the Empire Service, which uses a dual mode engine that primarily runs on diesel, but switches to electric when it reaches Penn Station. So in short, the best way to travel between Toronto and New York is by bus. And if you don't own an electric vehicle, the worst is via a flight or train. But what about longer distances? Do things change? Especially when you consider that a lot of the plane's emissions come from taxiing, takeoff, and landing, it seems like the longer the distance traveled, the more efficient the flight becomes. According to a peer-reviewed report by the Union of Concerned Scientists, the emissions associated with a 1,000-mile or 1,609-kilometer solo trip reveals some interesting conclusions. Taking the bus is still by far the best option due to its ability to transport a large amount of passengers on a comparably small amount of gas. Shockingly, however, flying in an economy seat has roughly the same carbon emissions associated with it when compared to a typical Amtrak train. As flights get longer, and if the flight is nonstop, the carbon load becomes smaller per mile. But if you're flying out of a congested airport with constant delays like Chicago's O'Hare, that footprint can balloon in size. Essentially, the more time the plane spends in the air going from point A to point B, and the less time it spends taxiing or circling the airport waiting for runway clearance, the more efficient it will be. Ultimately, the greenness of travel is heavily dependent on context. There is no hard and fast answer to the best form of travel for the environment. But if you are in desperate need of a rule of thumb, here's a tentative green transport lineup for a solo traveler. In general, a bus is better than a train, which is better than a plane, which trumps the average car and SUV. But that order can vary depending on distance traveled and the amount of passengers within that car. Ideally, an application like Google Maps could calculate the various emissions associated with your particular route and transportation options. That way, you'd be able to quickly understand the environmental consequences of your trip. Right now, however, we have to rely on carbon footprint calculators like TerraPass or Trip Zero, which can be a bit clunky and confusing to use. At the end of the day, we can only do so much to minimize our carbon footprint when traveling. Calculators and catching a greyhound are great, but innovations for infrastructure and technology are necessary in order to quickly decouple emissions from transportation. Rapid electrification of cars, buses, and trains, and the creation of a reliable clean energy grid will make the uncertain process of green transportation much more certain. One of the cornerstones of any clean energy grid is solar power. And in order to understand how to best harness the output from the sun, we need to understand the physics behind this renewable resource. Unfortunately, I don't really know much about physics, or for that matter, how a solar panel works. But luckily, Brilliant has an amazing course on the physics of solar panels. Brilliant is a problem-solving website that lets you explore the world of math and science by not just watching stuff, but by doing stuff. And that's exactly what you'll get when you'll dive into their solar energy course. The course is awesome because you're not just sitting back and reading. Instead, Brilliant peppers in all sorts of quizzes to keep you engaged and learning. Ultimately, if you're like me and like to learn through experience and interaction, Brilliant is the way to go. So, if you want to start learning about the physics behind solar energy, go to brilliant.org/OCC or click the link in the description and sign up for free. As a bonus, the first 200 people that go to that link will get 20% off their annual premium membership. Hey everyone, Charlie here. Thanks so much for making it all the way to the end of the video. I just want to give a quick shout out to all of my Patreon supporters who've helped me make this YouTube channel into a full-time pursuit. So thank you, thank you, thank you, and I will see you in 2 weeks.